tries to support the interstate river water dispute amendment bill. So I'd like to start with a quote by Brian Andreas, who said, "I like geography best because our rivers and mountains know the secret. Pay no attention to borders." But sir, in a utopian world, this may be true. But unfortunately, in the world of cutthroat hydropolitics and political demarcations, it is not reflective of our current reality. So when I wrote my book, A Rural Manifesto, last year, I wanted to see what the life of a river really was. I went to the Kaveri Delta in Tamil Nadu, and I went to Nagapattinam and Trichy. I went to Tanjavur and to Tiruvarur. And I went and I walked across the river with some academics and some people, sir. And what I found was deeply distressing to me. So I found that more than 50% of farmers, marginal farmers, have given up agriculture in the last 20 years there. So I found that when I came back, according to NCRB statistics 2014, 68 farmer suicides and 827 farm labor suicides in Tamil Nadu had taken place, out of which 67% belonged to the districts along the Kaveri Delta. So I also started looking at agriculture growth in those very districts, and I found that out of the 39 parliamentary constituencies constituting the state of Tamil Nadu, these five, six districts had the lowest agricultural growth in the entire state, three of them having negative agricultural growth over the last 10 years. Sir, I also found that in terms of government investment in irrigation, which all of us know is primarily a state subject, the lowest amount of government investment in irrigation and hydrology was done in those districts. Like nobody, sir, will buy a disputed property. Until people know the political future of a river, they tend not to invest or double down in it. So when we look at even in Karnataka, the violence that broke out in 2016, when you look at the damage to public property, urban infrastructure, railways, etc., it was a damage of 25,000 crores, sir, if you look at the effect of these disputes on people's livelihoods. So when we look at the construction of the SYL canal, I don't want to take any sides, sir, it's a very contentious issue. But I'd like to say that it's a lose-lose situation for both states. If you look at Haryana, sir, it's been unable to use 3 lakh hectares of irrigation potential, and it has lost incremental agriculture production of 8 lakh tons. But even Punjab, sir, in terms of water management, has not benefited in any manner. Today, 20 out of 22 districts are water deficit. And even if you look at, I'm not talking about urban local bodies, sir, but even if you look at the fact that 109 blocks out of 138 blocks in Punjab today are what you call dark zones in terms of groundwater, this is something, sir, we need to look at. This problem, sir, by the way, is not becoming better. In 2013 to 2016, the groundwater that's been taken out, extracted, has gone from 149 to 169% in Punjab. So these, we need to look at rivers not as bodies just of extraction. We need to look at rainwater harvesting, desalination, hydroponics, a whole slew of measures. So the solutions need to be sustainable and they need to be deliberative. So in terms of international examples, I looked at France, which the Honorable Minister is very knowledgeable, has water parliaments. So water parliaments are the agencies responsible for river and water management, and they have farmers, factory owners, government officials. They also have those members of parliament that belong to those riparian and riverine ecosystems. So they not only raise revenue and determine expenditure for managing the river, but they also look at it per square kilometer across the river. So the government introduced GST. Initially, it was contentious. But everybody then got together, and it became a success story for all of us unitedly. So my request to you and to the Honorable Minister is, can we have a deliberative process to combat this issue? Under Article 263 of the Indian Constitution, we can actually set up interstate councils for this. If we can make an effective use of an interstate council for water management, which can look at Central Water Commission, it can look at Central Groundwater Body, it can look at all these data management systems which are not put in place, we can really have a something that celebrates the federal structure as well as is overarching in terms of responsibility. So when we look at water management, it is a truth that unless we manage our water more efficiently, we will be more predatory towards each other. So we have irrigation efficiency of 30%. Unless we reach 60% in terms of drip irrigation, sprinkler systems, they will really not, in hydroponics, they need to be promoted. So the government of Karnataka has done something very good. They established the SCADA, which is the supervisory control and data acquisition system with GIS technology along the Krishna River to monitor and control both river flow and give real-time information to farmers for such. If we can do this for rivers across the country, it will... The Honorable Minister, sir, knows that the basin-focused approach is the future for hydrology, sir. And if we look at basins and sub-basins and don't take out more water than we put inside the Keola Deo sanctuary in Bharatpur, today is on the verge of not having enough water to replace its current ecological flora and fauna. Just one small example. So if we look at the Danube River Basin in Europe and how it was regenerated and reformed, the Honorable Minister knows very well, sir, that there is a River Basin Management Bill 2018. I plead before him to take this up on war footing and to see that it is revisited as long as we can, as soon as we can. Sir, to come to the bill, if you just permit me some time. So the Honorable Minister said that the bill, the Honorable Member before me said that the bill will take very long. But the fact is, sir, when we look at the Dispute Resolution Committee, which has been given a time of 1.5 years and then 4.5 years, sir, these are complex, enormous issues. They are respecting the federal structure of this country. There's a lot of back and forth which goes on. Sir, if you even look at the Godavari and Krishna dispute, which started in 1956 and was referred to a tribunal only 13 years later. So in that time frame, if we look at these issues, it's really not an enormous amount of time. So there is an issue which I'd like to talk about, which is the moot point of this whole bill, which is that a political problem, because these are essentially political problems, has to have a stream of political consciousness combating it. Mm-hmm. I cannot look at a political issue just being looked at by judicial powers, although I respect it. There needs to be a political solution to this. So my, when we look at the ex post mechanism of states not looking at awards that have been given, of we have looked at the government of Telangana has filed a SLP against the Krishna Water Dispute Tribunal too. There are several. I don't, the SYL, it's not one or two. My request to the minister is to tell us, will they be imposing fines on states for not obeying the tribunal's report? What is that corrective mechanism that will be taken? Because that is a little unclear to me, sir, in this. So when we look at the formation of a single permanent body, it is a major step in the right direction towards water management, towards solving these disputes. Just the go, the to and fro between notification, giving permission for a tribunal, etc., so has taken 20 years in some cases. It is unfortunate. So when, more than 20. So when we look at the composition of the tribunal, I'd like to thank the government for making it multidisciplinary. So we have one member from the disputed, the states which are party to the dispute in every body. We also have members from the Central Water Engineering Service, etc., etc. It is multidisciplinary with, of course, a judicial powers that be. So I just want to end my speech by saying that the more we look at water from a territorial perspective, everybody is going to lose. But if we look at water from a regenerative national resource perspective, make it ecologically sustainable, and pull together as a nation, this is something we looked at. Rumi, the famous poet, said that thousands have lived without love, not one without water. Yeah. I'd like to thank you for giving me the time, sir.